Malcolm was a truly lovely, friendly, warm, cuddly, fun, humorous person. But we realised that there were things that were definitely wrong.
He was particularly popular, I think, with people's parents. He was the nicest, most personal person. I'm sure they wanted to pair him off with my sister, but thank goodness he didn't.
He may look unassuming, but is one of the UK's most calculating killers.
A pathological liar driven by greed.
Speaking about Malcolm Webster, it certainly does make your skin crawl. Despite this veneer of plausibility, there was something shifty and just not quite right.
The psychopath is ultimately somebody who's conning and cunning and manipulative.
He's got a microphone on.
For 17 years, he believed he'd got away with the perfect murder.
To everyone who knew them and to Felicity Drumm herself, they seemed to have the perfect relationship.
Murderers that are going to escape detection for the longest will be geographically mobile because they cross police force boundary areas.
He fled back to Scotland, where he came up with a new deception.
Malcolm Webster turns up in Oban.
So on that day, I always thought he'd killed her.
We'd been boyfriend and girlfriend, and I might have been that victim. It's horrible.
Silly, isn't it? I can be friends with a murderer. Stupid, sorry.
Oban is one of Scotland's finest towns. And the people within the town are just the most generous people that you could come across. There are no surprises in Oban. It's a small place. You cannot change your knickers in Oban without everybody knowing about it.
It's a rural, family-focused area in many ways, and there is this sense of safety.
I can't remember the last time that I locked my car or my front door, even when I've been away on holiday. Those things make you feel quite safe.
The reason why I came to Oban was I'd just get married. My wife was having a child. I thought it'd be a great place to, you know, start a family.
Charles was originally a policeman in the West End of Glasgow. Charles was someone I particularly enjoyed working with and worked with him at different stages, at different times over a period of about 20 years.
Policing in Glasgow is 90 miles an hour stuff at times. Glasgow back then was a quite violent, kind of crime-ridden kind of place. At one particular point, it was nominated the murder capital of Europe. In Oban, you couldn't really be any more far removed than city centre policing.
Perhaps Charles thought he might be getting a slightly easier time in Oban. Of course, it was to turn out otherwise.
As many parts of the community as I touched as a journalist, people knew Malcolm. I think he just very quickly became part of the community here. Malcolm may have moved here because the jobs were quite hard to fill, and it would be a job that attracted quite a high salary. And I suppose if you're interested in sailing and you're interested in fishing, then it's an ideal place to come and live, really, isn't it?
You'd be well-spoken, plausible, you know, presented this air to him that was the J.R. Hartley fly fishing image, dressed in a country chic, the gilet and the expensive country clothes.
Malcolm was someone that people really loved in this town. The thing that made Malcolm trusted in Oban would be that he was trusted with a position within the hospital. That might not work in other communities or in other places, but in Oban, if you hold a position within this community of some responsibility, then there comes with that a level of trust.
When Malcolm Webster moved to Oban, it was said that he was quite popular, that he ingratiated himself with people. And yeah, I'm not really surprised to hear that. People look at him, they like him, he's quite important, he's needed, he's in the centre of everything. And everyone thinks, oh, he's such a great bloke.
It's hard to be a single woman in a rural Highland place because there's very few men to go about if you're looking for a man. And Malcolm was someone who wrote beautiful cards and sent beautiful flowers and was someone who made the women in his life exceptionally happy.
Malcolm Webster always seemed to have a partner. He wasn't somebody who went solo.
Simone Banerjee was his long-term partner in the Oban area. She held quite a senior position in the hospital, was a senior nurse and worked in surgery mostly. Her family was quite wealthy and she had a trust fund set up for her. She had quite a sizeable property in the Oban area. She also had a 50% share in a boat.
The club was formed in the 70s by local people within the area with a passion for fly fishing for brown trout. People pay an annual subscription. In return for that, we lease a number of waters and provide cheap or affordable fishing to our members. We provide a few boats, and it's as simple as that. You pay your money, you go fishing. Back in those days, we had vacant positions of secretary and treasurer in the club, which were always something of a poison chalice to the other members. And this is how Malcolm Webster came into the fold. I couldn't figure his motivation. In fact, he was probably the fishiest thing about the angling club. We'd determined funds were missing. 12 months to 18 months, we think there's nothing really particularly wrong, and then we begin to get this sniff that perhaps all is not right with the situation. Malcolm created a PO address because he was new and he didn't have somewhere where communications could be sent as both secretary and treasurer, like monies for subscriptions, and particularly cash, because, you know, people just put cash in an envelope. They'd always done that. Their money went, they got their membership card, they went fishing. It's as simple as the only one to do. Malcolm was pocketing that money. Because it was cash, there was no record. People were livid. People were absolutely livid. This is a small town, everybody knows each other or knows of you. To take people's hard-earned cash, it had left a bad feeling in the club.
You feel betrayed. These are people you trust and are working with for a common aim within the community.
It was then that we decided to escalate things and go to the local police.
That's the first time I came across the name Malcolm Webster. My colleague Peter gets the embezzlement inquiry. There is a chap, he's embezzling money out the fishing club in Oban. Probably about a week later, Peter comes to me and says, the people in the fishing club don't want us to carry on any further with that. They're telling me this individual has paid the money back and he has cancer.
He rocked up at my door one night with a cheque and gave it to me and then pissed off. You hear the news someone's got leukaemia, you're devastated. A young man, an effective death sentence, yeah, of course you're devastated. Who would be the man that would call someone out for having leukaemia? Would you do that?
One day, I'm coming back to the office and Peter had arranged an interview with this gentleman. Peter comes from the back door and dismisses this guy, saying, "It's okay, we don't need to speak to you." I walk past this individual at the time and walk out of the back of the office with Peter. Little did I know that that individual was probably going to change my life in a significant manner. Things started happening for us in November 2006. On three consecutive days, we started getting different intelligence logs about the person of interest residing in your area. It was believed that he had committed offences in New Zealand. That changed everything in Oban. Those intelligence logs would be the start of the most memorable part of my police career.
He had a very good sense of humour. He could be very personable, very attentive. I wouldn't say he was the only one true love of my life, but I loved him.
Malcolm met Felicity Drumm working in the Middle East in 1996. There was a mutual decision to move to New Zealand. They were married the following year. Malcolm and Felicity had found a house. The arrangement was that Felicity would put her funds to the house, Malcolm would put his funds to the house, and they would buy quite a big house in New Zealand together.
Around about the time that I discovered I was pregnant, and in the ensuing months after that, I started noticing a bitter, acrid taste in my food. I literally described it as if someone has crushed tablets and put them in my food. It was a chemical, acrid, disgusting taste.
Felicity had various sleeping episodes, dizziness. I'd been asleep for 36 hours. Didn't really know where that time had gone. They discovered that she had sleep drugs in her system. Obviously, Felicity hadn't been taking any of those kind of drugs. So the suspicion was that Malcolm had been drugging her.
He drugged me because he could, and then he got off on that somehow. It was a game to him, on a whim. He could put me to sleep.
Felicity had already given a deposit for it. They were waiting on Malcolm putting his portion of the money together. He had assured them that it was en route and the money was there, but that wasn't the case. They were en route to conclude the deal for the house. Malcolm was driving and the car swerved off the road. And at that particular point, Malcolm says, "I'm going to have a heart attack." The suspicion by the family was that Malcolm had fabricated the accident to cover up for the fact that he hadn't paid any money towards the house.
Malcolm was insistent on every day travelling on long car journeys.
Felicity and Malcolm were driving in the countryside. They had their baby at that particular point. The baby was in the back of the car. Felicity was encouraged to take drinks, which Malcolm had prepared. She was basically sleeping by the time they got to this beauty spot in New Zealand. She woke up to see Malcolm disappearing off into the bush with the baby. She was awoken in the car by her father phoning her. He was alerting her to the fact that money had been taken out of her account and to leave the car and return home. The implication was that he drugged her and he was setting her up to murder her.
What I believe was that he was taking our son to a place of safety and that his intention was to come back and set fire to the car. Because subsequently, when we did return and met up with my father, he popped the boot of his car and in it discovered a 10-litre container of petrol. I felt so humiliated at, you know, the breathtaking extent of his deception and how I was so immersed in it that I couldn't see it.
Felicity and her father searched places where Malcolm kept documents after this, and he'd found 9 life assurance policies signed by Felicity that she knew absolutely nothing about, which totaled in the region of about £1 million.
I have spent at different times a lot of time agonising over what was real and what wasn't. Did I ever mean anything to him? Was I purely a meal ticket right from the start?
It appeared obvious that Malcolm had taken out these policies on her without her knowledge, implying that Malcolm was intent in causing Felicity some serious harm.
The initial files, intelligence, all came to me. And I had discussions with colleagues in CID and Grampian Police, who frankly shared my concerns as well. The documents, the signature of Felicity Drumm, as I understand it, was not her signature that was on it. So the suspicion that I had at the start of this operation was that Malcolm Webster was forging, potentially was forging his wife's signature and taking out insurances on her life without her knowledge. And I think that that raises the danger level. Why would someone take out life insurance secretly?
I'm getting told in the intelligence logs that Malcolm Webster works in the hospital in Oban. Intelligence files, there's not a great deal of detail in them. You're trying to make a risk assessment on this individual and you quickly realise you need to find out more information.
To arrest anyone, the police need evidence, and evidence that is reliable and evidence that will stand up in court. What we had was very strong suspicion.
What we thought was we'll contact New Zealand, get more of the story from them. We called the investigating officer for the incidents in New Zealand. His reaction was, I'm waiting for you to call and it's about time. Alarm is setting in, picked up the phone, spoke to the boss. You're starting to formulate a plan in your head. How are we going to deal with this individual?
I was worried about what we could do. Malcolm Webster was a very significant threat to females he was involved with in terms of personal relations.
Malcolm Webster was a predator. He always had his eye on the best chance, but it had to be a fight he could win.
there were certain women, probably, that he wouldn't have had a chance with. It's a predator.
The key function of Operation Liffey was to stop Malcolm Webster from causing harm, killing. And the primary focus of that was, of course, Simone Bannerjee, who was by that time his partner.
There was, for us, a high degree of suspicion that he tried to kill his wife in New Zealand, and he was setting up Simone, possibly, to be the next victim, to feed his own particular lifestyle. We thought that we had a particularly devious, calculating individual who was, given the right set of circumstances, intent on serious harm, and we needed to find out as much as we humanly could as quickly as possible.
Things are quite literally at life and death. The function here was to stop something happening to another human being. The key function was to safeguard whoever Malcolm Webster was in a relationship with. And the primary focus of that was, of course, Simone Bannerjee, who was by that time his partner. And the basis for that was, of course, the events involving Felicity Drumm in New Zealand. Also, from a police officer's point of view, pointed to possible investigative opportunities in relation to the death of Claire Morris.
Pan, Pan. She's got a microphone on. Oh, earthquake!
Malcolm was married to Claire Morris. She was his first wife. She was English, and they moved up to Aberdeen to live and work up there.
I only got to know Claire as Malcolm's intended, Malcolm's partner. He had a wonderful life. He had girlfriend after girlfriend. So we were used to seeing really nice girls who would come and be as, you know, pal for a few months. And anyway, that's normal at that age of 20, you know, you're expecting to see people for a few months. But this one was more serious. There was no question. I think I only met her when they were engaged. I only knew that she'd come from a nursing background. It was fairy tale in the sense that everything came together. You know, friends of friends who knew other friends, and then it all magically came together.
I worked with Malcolm for a considerable time before I met Claire. He was in quite a senior role in the NHS in Grampian, working as the kind of nurse and computer expert. I became very close to Claire quite quickly because she was such a wonderful person. She was very caring for everyone. Her personality was very bubbly, very positive, and always thought the best of everyone.
The wedding was lovely because it was a lot of people who knew each other. It was in Scotland. It was very lively because they were so welcoming. The whole event was. She was very sweet, very kind, very gentle. The ideal partner for Malcolm, as far as we all thought, absolutely perfect. The only thing that really stuck for me at the time was that she was young, she was pretty, and yet she had to go and sleep in the afternoon. And it was always, I need to go and have a nap.
Claire was clear to me that she was feeling odd, just generally very exhausted. She put that down to the additional studying she was doing for her master's in nursing. But behind it, she did feel that there was something going on. She thought she had some, you know, cancer or some other condition. A close friend of Malcolm, who was my manager, called me and said to me she had some news for me that Malcolm had been in an accident.
My understanding is that Malcolm Webster was driving from home to his place of work at Aberdeen Hospital. His wife, Claire Morris, was in the passenger seat. At some stage, he took a different route, which took him down an unlit country lane, quite a narrow country lane.
Malcolm Webster lived in a local town, and the scene of the accident was on the Harton Crook. It's a single track road. It's quite bending. It's a road that you cannot travel in speed.
While driving along, a motorcyclist came towards him and he swerved off the road to avoid a collision. He veered off to the left and drove down quite a steep embankment, maybe 20 or 30 feet, before being stopped by saplings and trees that were in the way.
I was brought to my attention that there was an accident within the wee woods. There was a vehicle that was burnt out.
The bonnet had been prized up by fire brigade activity to obviously try and extinguish the fire. But in terms of physical damage to the car, virtually nothing. There were no big dents. In terms of fire damage, it was completely gutted. The passenger seat was open. The body of Claire Morris was still sitting in the passenger seat. The original conclusion that was made at the time was it was an accidental fire caused by the ignition of petrol from the system being ignited by the hot manifold.
I was working in France. I was in the middle of an open plan office, and a close friend rang me at work, which in itself was unusual, and said, I need you to know that Malcolm's had an accident and that Claire didn't make it. And I was so shocked and horrified. And it was so short after the wedding as well. It was only a matter of months, or it felt like it anyway. It was so short. And so I remember leaving work. I actually had to leave work. Yeah, that was a horrible, horrible day. He was devastated when I went to see him in the UK. When he came to see me, he was in pieces still, absolutely in pieces. And that was when we went out and we had terrible floods of tears at different times, and he was in a real state still and struggling with it, as anybody would be after only a few weeks, perhaps.
At the funeral, Malcolm had entered the church with a neck brace and in a wheelchair, and was looking like a very old man, just like it was all too much for him. He was certainly looked like he was grieving and like he was upset.
The day of the funeral is related to me by Claire's brother, Peter. At the graveside, Peter was standing alongside Malcolm, who, as the coffin was being lowered into the grave, began wailing, howling. Peter was obviously upset. He'd lost his sister, but Malcolm was wailing and howling, just totally grief-stricken, and Peter said to me that he held Malcolm's hand.
A week or so after the funeral, Malcolm turned up at our cottage in a top-of-the-range Range Rover. No sign of the wheelchair, no sign of the neck brace, no sign of any injury. He said he was feeling far better, not got any after effects of the crash, which surprised me. I said, how can you afford this? And he said, oh, luckily Claire's well insured, so, you know, I was able to buy it. And then went on to describe that he would be thinking about buying a yacht.
He was a very good sailor, yeah. But he bought the boat because he and Claire had always wanted to sail. So that's why he bought it.
From that day, I always thought he'd killed her. I'm thinking, this doesn't all add up here. But nobody that close to me really believed me. My own husband didn't believe me.
You had to add up the incidents in New Zealand, right? Once you add that up, it does point you in a direction that he had been responsible for the death of his first wife. That made us worried for our people and our citizens because he was living in our midst. He's with this woman, Simone. I was worried that there was going to be an incident here, right, in this neck of the woods, and I wasn't able to stop it, or my team wasn't able to stop it. She was a resident in my area, and it was my responsibility, ultimately, to look after her.
Well, we couldn't arrest Malcolm Webster for the murder of Claire Morris for a number of reasons. Firstly, we didn't have jurisdiction. It was a Grampian police investigation. Secondly, to arrest someone for murder, you need to prove that they actually were murdered. The death certificate for Claire Morris would indicate that she'd been killed in a road traffic accident.
The best possible way that we saw at that time to protect our citizens was to get Grampian to launch a murder investigation into the death of Claire Morris.
There was quite a strong will within part of the CID and Grampian Police to reopen this. They shared the suspicions that Charles Henry and I had. However, I am told that the powers that be within the organisation and beyond felt that there wasn't sufficient evidence to reopen the case of Claire Morris.
Frustrations was building up on us. Did it deflate us? No, it just made us more determined to try to get the right result. I wasn't going to let go of this one. You know, we didn't have the luxury of forgetting about this. We were living with it. So it's like there was never for a moment that we were going to stop.
We brought in a forensic psychologist to look at the information that we had. Charles Henry and I met with the forensic psychologist who offered a particular view. Based on some of his findings, he suggested we go back and timeline the life of Malcolm Webster.
I always use a phrase that the best indication of future behaviour is past behaviour. And if you're informed as a police force area that you've got somebody who in another police force jurisdiction attempted to commit a murder, and there is evidence from that person's past in which one of his previous partners had died in seemingly suspicious circumstances, I would be looking very carefully at the past behaviour of an offender, because the leopard doesn't change its spots.
Our consultant psychologist suggested to us that we want to look into this guy's background. He said, you know, go right the way back to his childhood. We wanted this part of the investigation to remain reasonably covert. We didn't want it leaking back to Malcolm, so we were trying to find individuals in his background that weren't necessarily going to tell him anything. Surrey is a well-to-do area, predominantly middle class. Malcolm had a reasonably privileged upbringing. He came from a good background, went to a private school.
I must have met Malcolm, I'd have been about 14, probably 15, at a church youth group. Neither was particularly church-related. It's a village, there aren't many places to meet people, and so everybody went there. And they had a church hall, and it was wonderful.
Janet was a friend of Malcolm. As far as I was aware, they were never in a relationship. She was slightly on edge. Two Scottish detectives turning up at her door, but she was totally welcoming, totally free with her information.
His mum was quiet, but that was pretty normal in those days. His father was, he was in the police, pleasant, welcoming, strict, and he was a big bear of a chap. And we all thought that's where Malcolm got it from as well, because he was sort of a big bear as well. So yeah, they were very similar.
My elder sister Janet became good friends with him, and Malcolm would be around the whole time. So we all seemed to live in each other's houses quite a lot as we were growing up.
There was nothing negative about him to even notice. He wasn't shy, he wasn't difficult, he was easygoing, he was easy to talk to. He made so many people's lives better.
I knew Malcolm Webster in the late 1970s. I knew he had a bit of a reputation as a player, so I was kind of aware I was maybe one girlfriend in a long line. So I remember feeling a bit awkward. He wasn't terribly good looking, but I think he had a very entertaining and engaging personality, and that must have won the women over.
One of the things that one constantly hears from women that knew Malcolm Webster, they will say, you know, he had great manners, he was well-spoken, he was a very kind of plausible character when he first met these women. So plausible, in fact, that they could fall, as it were, head over heels in love with him. And every time Malcolm Webster started a new relationship, he would have ensured that he was absolutely everything that that prospective partner wanted to see and hear.
I remember there was this kind of illness as well surrounding him, which I'm not sure how true it was. I'm probably just not a very sympathetic person, so there were a few occasions, I think, where he seemed to faint or behave a bit strangely, and I just let it go. But I think women are quite often susceptible to that. They're quite like someone that's a bit unwell. They're like, that's sort of nursing instinct. I don't know what it is, but I've seen it with other people.
He went to some extraordinary lengths to make people think he had cancer. And that worked for him. That worked for him. He had learned that people who are openly suffering with cancer get treated differently, more kindly, more gently. He would only have to go around there and turn the tears on.
I remember my mother thought, oh, it's all too much. You know, you're seeing too much of him. It's all too much too soon. She just didn't really trust him the way it was so full on so quickly. And she was probably right, but of course, when you're well, you never take notice from your parents, do you?
I believed he was a genuinely nice person, which transpires later to have some not very nice traits. But the only thing unusual, I think all small boys have a like of fire. His was bordering on an obsession. Hence his nickname. So his nickname was Pyro. It wasn't just a bit of an obsession, it was a total obsession. That was in the Scouts. From the moment you got off the bus, he was straight away sorting the fire out. And it became a bit of a standing joke that it was known as Malcolm's fire. After being at camp for 2 or 3 days, people stopped referring to him as Malcolm. And he was definitely pyro.
It was a kind of shock. Malcolm, when he was a youngster, he was nicknamed Pyro.
A pyromaniac would be somebody who would find pleasure in deliberately setting fires. Often young people go through a process of maturity in which they will set fires, and they do that almost with peers, and they kind of challenge one another.
Everyone likes poking around with a fire, but I've never seen anyone who could just stare at it constantly. And to the point where, going away with a scout, we'd go and eat, and he would go and grab some food and almost rush back, as though it was his thing to nurture, it was his baby.
The pyromaniac who sets fires by himself is often somebody who doesn't run away, but who sits and waits and watches and rather enjoys the fact that his behaviour has resulted in lots of people then having to come to put the fire out.
Fires seem to appear at various stages throughout the timeline of Malcolm Webster's existence. Not quite everywhere that Malcolm goes, but certainly there's a lot more fires going round about his presence than the average person, I would suggest.
I remember speaking to Charles, and he said, if you plot where Malcolm's worked across Scotland, and then you plot unexplained fires in hospitals across Scotland, there's a remarkable coincidence similarity between the two. He never said Malcolm's responsible for all those. He just pointed out there was an interesting trait.
Taking him right back to the very start, he worked at a nursing home in the Surrey area, and a fire was discovered outside his room. Moving forward, he was involved in a number of fires in the Aberdeen area. One was in a house that he occupied. Another was at the Shore Porters storage facility in Aberdeen.
There were fires out in New Zealand at the house of Felicity Drumm's parents. There was also a fire of sorts at a house in New Zealand that Malcolm and Felicity Drumm planned in buying, bearing in mind Claire Morris died in a fire, albeit it was categorised at that time as a road traffic accident.
In relation to Malcolm Webster was a repeated ingrained piece of behaviour that we see emerging in his childhood but continuing when he was an adult and in relation to his offending. It's a way that he can enjoy the attention that comes from his behaviour.
Approximately 2001, I got a phone call from my sister asking me to go round to meet with her and a couple of other friends who at that point had all got together and were raised suspicions in relation to Malcolm.
We were all feeling really sympathetic because he'd had such terrible things happen in his life. And shortly after Claire had died, there'd been a fire in a warehouse, I think, when he'd moved from one place to another. And so he'd lost a lot of her possessions and his. And we talked about this fire and how unfortunate it was, real bad luck, how could this terrible things happen to the same person? And somebody made some joke about, well, of course, couldn't be Malcolm, because he was staying with you. And the scholar said, no, he wasn't. He was staying with you that day. No, he was with you. I know, he told us. No, he told us he'd come up to visit you on that day. That's the point when the hairs in the back of your neck start to stand up. And you think, wait a minute. He's been telling different things to different people. That's when, I guess, all contact was dropped. And so we just left it quiet, really, and lost touch, if I'm honest. Which was sad.
There's a kind of mythomania about Webster that one detects. He likes the sense of being in control. He likes the sense of being powerful. He likes the sense of outwitting people, not only outwitting his partner, but outwitting his partner's family by outwitting all of his partner's friends. by outwitting the criminal justice system. But when you add all those things up, ultimately, I think we're dealing with somebody who has got an underlying personality disorder, and I would label that as psychopathy. The psychopath is ultimately somebody who's conning and cunning and manipulative, and it's usually characterized by three different clusters of traits. The first is interpersonal style. The psychopath will be charming, seducing. The second cluster would be a defective emotional experience. This is not somebody who classically can walk in your shoes. The psychopath might know the words, but he doesn't know how they feel. And the third cluster would be about behaviors. The psychopath is really engaging in risk-taking behaviors. Webster was constantly setting fires. But the key thing, these are traits that have existed in them for a long period of time and will be repeated time after time after time.
Charles Henry and I strongly suspected that Malcolm Webster was going to try and murder Simone Bannatyne when the time was right. I asked for permission to advise Simone Bannatyne of what we thought about her level of risk from Malcolm Webster, and that was refused.
Support information for the issues raised can be found online at channel4.com/support. And for the full story, you can stream all episodes of Married to a Psychopath right now on All Four.
Malcolm was a truly lovely, friendly, warm, cuddly, fun, humorous person. But we realised that there were things that were definitely wrong.
He was particularly popular, I think, with people's parents. He was the nicest, most personal person. I'm sure they wanted to pair him off my sister, but thank goodness they didn't.
He may look unassuming, but is one of the UK's most calculating killers.
A pathological liar driven by greed.
Speaking about Malcolm Webster, it certainly does make your skin crawl. Despite this veneer of plausibility, there was something shifty and just not quite right.
The psychopath is ultimately somebody who's conning and cunning and manipulative.
Just got a microphone on.
For 17 years, he believed he'd got away with the perfect murder.
The function here was to stop something happening to another human being.
If there's money to be had, why shouldn't he have it? He's better than them anyway.
I strongly suspected Malcolm Webster was going to try and murder Simone Bannatyne when the time was right.
I could see horrible things happening and me being powerless to stop them.
Let's get evidence and have Malcolm Webster placed under arrest. If he's in prison, he can't do any harm.
When he found a sample, it was a kind of eureka moment.
When suspicion crystallised in my mind that Malcolm Webster had very probably murdered Claire Morris, had almost certainly tried to murder Felicity Drumm, and therefore that now placed Simone Bannatyne in Oban under, in my view, very significant risk.
Malcolm, we learn, discloses at some particular point that he's got cancer to her, and it's coming up to Christmas time. He's telling her that he's on his own, and she doesn't want to see him alone at Christmas, and she invites him into the household at Christmas. And from there, they develop more of a relationship.
At the time that the operation on Malcolm Webster started, we sought to develop intelligence sources that we could find out things about Malcolm from, try to build up a picture of what Malcolm was doing on a daily basis.
Our source at the hospital was asked to tell us everything she knew about the pair. So on one of our meetings, she said that Malcolm and Simone were engaged. We were able to establish that Malcolm and Simone had contributed to a pension. They both changed that pension to have a sole benefactor. So that NHS pension has a life assurance built-in policy attached to it. So in the event of Simone's death, he would be the benefactor by way of a lump sum.
I was aware that following the death of Claire Morris, Malcolm Webster had received a fairly substantial insurance payout. That raised the threat level, the concern level, sky high. Once they are married, he stands to inherit.
When Malcolm Webster moved to Oban, it was said that he was quite popular, that he ingratiated himself with people. And yeah, I'm not really surprised to hear that, because he would have learned all through his life that speaking to people in this way, ingratiating himself, being very, very friendly and open, gets him what he wants. In this respect, Malcolm Webster is not unusual. He is behaving the way that many psychopaths before him have behaved, using the same tactics.
That veneer of plausibility is, I think, what took many people in. I remember when I had my suspicions falling out badly with my wife at the time, who worked at the hospital. We went through a long period of time not speaking to each other because I said I smelled a rat. Something just was not adding up about this person. And in reply, I was told that Malcolm was a well-respected member of the hospital staff, and you can't just go around making wild accusations about people like that.
To arrest someone for murder, you need to prove that they actually were murdered. The death certificate for Claire Morris would indicate that she'd been killed in a road traffic accident. That's an accident, that's not homicide.
Without that evidence, there's only so much you can do. This is frustrating because you've still got a potential murderer on your hands, living in your area, potentially going to murder one of your citizens.
Charles Henry and I strongly suspected that Malcolm Webster was going to try and murder Simone Bannatyne when the time was right.
An Osmond letter was brought in to protect people, and it's a letter that goes from police officers to tell someone that the person they are seen to be in a relationship with has a violent, seriously violent past.
I asked for permission to give such an Osmond warning to advise Simone Bannatyne of what we thought about her level of risk from Malcolm Webster, and that was refused. I found that difficult to understand. Frankly, still do.
I was expressly forbidden from telling her anything by the first solicitor, and also from the point of view, if there was a murder investigation, it might tarnish any particular evidence that we accrued from Simone.
Malcolm Webster was a predator. He's a psychopath. He only cares about himself. He really doesn't care about anybody else. He doesn't have the ability to empathise. So he views opportunities that come in his path in a very different way, maybe, to a non-psychopath. So if there's money to be had, he will spot ways that he can get his hands on that money, because why shouldn't he have it? He's better than them anyway.
I think Malcolm Webster was a very sophisticated offender. I think that Malcolm Webster had thought very carefully about his modus operandi, the means by which he would go about offending. And he also had some things in his background that we can also see that would have helped him to have thought through how he would go about offending. Specifically, his father, Sandy, was a former detective chief superintendent of the fraud squad in the Metropolitan Police. That quite simply means that he would have heard a great deal of policing being discussed when he was growing up. And he would have known, therefore, how you could avoid detection, how you might be able to get away with offending. And therefore, I think it was quite calculated, a number of these decisions, as opposed to them simply being circumstantial.
Our source at the hospital, she was able to tell us that they were planning a honeymoon, which would be on board Simone's yacht, and it would be a transatlantic trip from the Canary Islands over the Caribbean. We thought that this might be an ideal opportunity for Malcolm to murder Simone and possibly her family if they decided to go with them on that trip.
What would happen if the parents plus Simone ended up in the middle of the Atlantic and we never found the bodies? This was a real challenge.
The nursing manager, she tells us, "Do you know about the bin fire?" I says, "Well, what bin fire is that?" This is all Malcolm was discovered the fire at patient's room, and he was the one that put it out.
A fire in a hospital, the size of Oban, is quite catastrophic because it's a small place, everything's connected, people are very vulnerable. And when the bin fire happened, initially, Malcolm was named as a bit of a hero for putting the fire out.
That room was occupied by only one patient, an elderly patient who had some form of advanced dementia. And the first person on the scene, armed with a fire extinguisher, was Malcolm Webster.
Over time, people would come and tell me a story. And when I say people, I'm talking about four or five people at all different positions within the hospital who raised concerns about it, who said, "Actually, I think there's more to that story. There's something more has happened here." Of interest when you work in a local paper, whether it's a false alarm or whether it's a bigger fire. But a fire at the hospital is something that we'd have come across our desk and we would have been thinking, well, that's strange. That's a strange thing to have happened in the hospital.
The elderly patient was in a room alone, in bed, and the doctor's view was that he didn't have the necessary digital dexterity to even operate a cigarette lighter. And moreover, this patient has such advanced dementia, wouldn't be able to tell us what had happened inside that room. It caused us to suspect Malcolm Webster may have been the person who'd actually ignited the waste paper inside the waste paper bucket.
Malcolm was one of very few nurses on duty within that ward. Between the fire starting and it being discovered, according to the fire service, would have been a short period of time.
I remember speaking to one woman at the time who named Malcolm and said it was him that had lit the fire. But there was no evidence of that.
We decided to investigate that particular episode. That was based on the fact of this nickname of Pyro, and fires seeming to appear at various stages throughout the timeline of Malcolm Webster's existence.
There was a fire at our cottage. There was a huge blaze at the Shaw Porters Shipping Company. There was a fire at my parents' home. There was a fire at the property that we were purchasing in Bayswater.
Bearing in mind, Claire Morris died in the fire, albeit it was categorised at that time as a road traffic accident.
The bin fire was a huge moment because it allowed us to present new and relevant information to our force solicitor and the hierarchy within Strathclyde Police that this guy was a present danger to the individuals here.
Charles Henry arranged for us to go to the Oban and Lawn Hospital to see Simone Bannatyne. So Charles Henry and I saw her in a private room within the hospital. I certainly sensed hostility from her. We fulfilled our obligation in terms of advising her of what we suspect, but the suspicion we were given was pretty general. I was limited from what I could articulate because my instructions were the terms of that letter, that's what gets read out. You can't see anything more. That is the extent of the disclosure of our intelligence. It's contained in that letter.
The shock that she must have been in, because this isn't a neighbour saying to her, I think he means you harm, this is the police. How do you process that information? What do you do with that information? You have to believe it first.
They explained to me they had a letter for me that they would read to me first and then that they would give me to keep, and also warned me that my life would be in danger should I wish to continue my relationship with Malcolm. I thought it was complete nonsense. I'd never heard such a load of bunkum in the whole of my life. This could not be the Malcolm Webster that I knew and loved.
She fixated on one phrase within that letter, and that was his now wife in New Zealand, Felicity Drumm.
And it dawned on me that Mr. Webster had not told her about the wife in New Zealand.
She was obviously visibly upset by this. She turned round to us and said, I suppose you're going to tell us that he's not got cancer either. We actually stared blankly back at her. Of course I knew the truth.
Perhaps I was a bit naive. I don't think I was, because it wasn't just myself. There were, apart from the women, there was a whole hospital of people who thought he had leukaemia. He was very, very clever.
Often there is a great deal of narcissism within people who are psychopathic. They want to draw attention to themselves. And the way that they can draw attention to themselves is being incredibly vulnerable. So in Malcolm Webster's case, he feigns the fact that he's got leukemia. He would claim to have epilepsy. He would claim to have had a brain tumour. This is all something that we usually call Munchausen syndrome, this idea of feigning illness or feigning the symptoms of illness, which is meant to draw attention to you. It's meant to give you some sense of people would have to focus their attention on you.
I remember being on scout camp and Malcolm didn't emerge from his tent. And I remember asking the scout leaders what's happened. And said, oh, he's sleeping, leave him alone. And he was in the tent for well over 24 hours. And I remember asking, why is he sleeping for 24 hours? Everyone else is up having a good time. It's to do with his illness. And it was only probing a little bit further, and we said, well, he's got cancer. And we can't disturb him, he needs just to be left alone. I didn't press any further. All I knew that it was someone that I liked was very ill. About 48 hours after he first went into his tent, he came out, emerged as though nothing had ever happened.
illness is an incredibly powerful tool in that toolbox of Malcolm Webster. It can get him out of a sticky situation. He went to some extraordinary lengths to make people think he had cancer. And that worked for him. That worked for him. He had learned that people who are openly suffering with cancer get treated differently.
I felt that we've just devastated this woman's life. But at the same particular point, there was absolutely no detail or context to what we just told her. So I had to think, I'm not allowed to tell her stuff, but maybe somebody else is. I could put her in touch with the reporting officer in New Zealand. If he was allowed to, he would be able to go into some detail, and he would confirm to her also that he was still married, right, and had a child. She would conclude from that that her position with him was no longer tenable.
She was going to go home that night, but we did not know how Malcolm Webster would react to this.
We asked her to do it at such a time that we would be available or in the vicinity. Should anything untoward happen, we were very, very close by.
We made sure there was police officers literally within metres of her house when she returned home. And until she contacted Charles Henry and his team and said, everything's fine, they remained there.
She told them that she got a letter from us. And I think she told them that she'd had a conversation with the police in New Zealand, and that I think the majority of the conversation surrounded the fact that he was still married. We saw him taking his car and he drove in a particular direction towards Glasgow. So that was it for the moment.
What was it about this man that enabled him to make himself attractive to you all?
Well, I think that comes from being the first impression of a fine, well-spoken, nicely dressed person with good manners, is what the immediate impact is when you meet him. And then he's always very polite, treats you well. So there's nothing really that somebody wouldn't like about him.
When we're talking about love, you've got to remember that Malcolm Webster didn't love anybody.
Pan. Has this got a microphone on?
Malcolm Webster knows that there is a word called love, and he knows the behaviours that are associated with that word and what that word implies about a relationship. He knows that he should bring flowers when it's somebody's birthday. He knows that on an anniversary that you should go out for somewhere to eat. He's inauthentic. He's not real. Those emotions are something that he's mirroring because he's seen how people behave when they're in love, but he himself doesn't feel it. And of course, because Felicity, because Claire, because Simone are in love, that gives Webster an advantage because they allow him in, and therefore they're vulnerable because he knows everything about them. And ultimately, that perverted intimacy will allow him, in the right circumstances, to kill.
Malcolm Webster became the subject of four warrants after failing to appear in court in New Zealand in 2000. Now 48 years old, Malcolm Webster's current whereabouts are not known.
We decided as best we could we would keep tabs on him as far as we could do, but we had no authority to follow him anywhere.
What we did was try and keep tabs on where he was living, because the intelligence dossier that we had developed in terms of Operation Liffey, our view was that Mr. Webster did not just represent a threat to Simone Bannatyne. He may potentially represent a threat to any other female that he forms a romantic relationship with. And given he seemed to have quite a skill at developing friendships with ladies, it was a matter of continuing concern to the operation that we had to alert the authorities, the police, in any of the areas where he chose to live. We strongly believed it was murder. We couldn't show that, even though the circumstances were striking between what happened in New Zealand and what I've declared Morris. We would need to come up with significant evidence to get that murder case effectively opened again. Let's get evidence and have Malcolm Webster placed under arrest. If he's in prison, he can't do any harm.
Neil Thompson and I went to Aberdeen to meet the senior police officers. We asked them if they'd considered looking for a liver sample that still might exist to see if there was any drugs in Claire Morris's system.
I suspected that there is liable to be body tissue taken at her post-mortem examination following the road traffic death. A histology sample is a small piece of plastic with a very, very thin piece of body tissue. And I knew that historically they kept an awful lot. If we couldn't find those particular histology samples, we would have been unable to test any body tissue which remained of Claire Morris for the presence of drugs which she did not voluntarily take. Because that appeared to be what had happened in New Zealand. Felicity Drumm was being drugged by Malcolm Webster.
Thompson, he was aware that from time to time the pathology lab keep small samples, small slides of deceased liver so that they can check back at a later point to see if there's any hereditary illnesses. So he suggested that what Grampian Police might want to do is search for that sample and see if it could be tested to see if there was any drugs in Claire Morris's system.
The thing that we associate with Webster in all of his crimes is drugging the people that he's going to victimise. Now, Webster doesn't drug so as to kill. Webster drugs so as to control and incapacitate. He wants to engage in a long period of time with that drugging. He likes the journey that he's on. So he doesn't want to kill outright. He wants to repeatedly drug because it's the process. That's the process that he enjoys as opposed to the destination he's going to get to.
On the day after I'd found out that Claire had been killed, I'd gone to the cottage with a colleague to get clothes for Malcolm to take to the hospital. So I'm looking around the room, there's a small table, and I see all these brown bottles of medication. That at this point I'm thinking, this is extremely unusual. What kind of household of two people needs all this medication? Then I'm thinking there's something unusual about the bottles, and I'm looking, I'm thinking, they're hospital pharmacy bottles. They're not the bottles that people would get given from a chemist.
When I was informed that he found a sample, it was a kind of eureka moment. Grampian Police got the sample back, which showed temazepam in Claire Morris's system.
She wasn't prescribed any drugs that would cause that. So that raised suspicion, sky high, that she had been drugged prior to that road traffic accident, and drugged in a fashion which appeared to be very similar to the drugging that had taken place some years later in New Zealand with Malcolm Webster's second wife, Felicity Drumm. The parallels between these two events were striking, almost astonishing. That takes the investigation, you know, into the stratosphere in terms of proving a potential homicide case involving Claire Morris.
They were able then to launch a fully funded, fully resourced murder investigation.
It's years since Claire Webster was killed at this spot in Aberdeenshire.
Police have now confirmed they're reviewing the circumstances of the car crash that killed Claire Webster.
Late 2007, I received a call from a Grampian police officer. They wanted to reassess the original investigation. So I was provided with statements made by the eyewitnesses at the time, the people that came across the car. And we don't know what time the crash happened, but what we do know is that around 12:30, one witness drives past, sees a car down the embankment. Malcolm seems fine, and yet another 10 minutes after that, another car passes and stops. And at this stage, they start to see a fire developing in the engine compartment of the car. So at least 20 minutes after the crash, a fire is then seen to develop.
He told me, when we were in France, he told me all about it, that they'd had this crash, gone into a tree, he crawled out of the car, he was on the road, and another car had found him on the road, picked him up, and as they picked him up, the car exploded. And he told me he will never forget the sound of Claire's screams, which was a horrific thing to hear from him, and also for him, you know, that he was going through that.
I remember being very struck by a report which said that one of the first members of the public on the scene who arrived saw Malcolm Webster, and this particular member of the public started saying to Malcolm Webster, "Is there anybody else in the car, or what's to that effect?" And he replied, "No." And then, as I understand how events unfolded, tragically, that car then explodes. And it's only when that car is now engulfed in flames does information come from Malcolm along the lines of, "My wife's inside there."
I think my first impressions were that it didn't look right. Something was wrong. Clearly, you know, it's common knowledge, cars catch fire. Fire develops very quickly, but that's usually a result of spillage from the fuel tank. But in my experience, that's an almost instantaneous occurrence. In this particular case, we had an interval of at least 20 minutes. That time delay suggested that there'd been perhaps some kind of bonfire built within the engine compartment, possibly newspapers, maybe with a splash of petrol just to get it going. Scientifically, I can't say precisely where it started, how it started, but I was able to eliminate these accidental causes and bring my conclusion to the fact that this was not an accidental fire.
This afternoon, 49-year-old Malcolm John Webster appeared here in private. He was charged in connection with fraudulence to obtain life assurance monies and to obtain that involving the murder of his then-wife. His lawyer said he denies vehemently any wrongdoing.
I didn't necessarily feel proud, but I was relieved that we got to that situation.
Here at the High Court, the case was called today of 51-year-old Malcolm Webster. Now, the charges against Mr. Webster run to 11 pages in what is a complex case. Mr. Webster denies all the charges against him, and the trial is expected to last between 4 and 5 months.
When I went to the trial, it was really difficult. It was in Glasgow, and it was really hard because I remember going there and you had to queue outside, all the jury and everybody and witnesses all queuing outside. And I saw Malcolm coming along the road. And of course, I hadn't seen him for several years. And my absolute instinct was to run and give him a hug. I was like, yeah, I haven't seen you for ages. How are you? And I had to stop myself and go, no, no, the situation's different now. I can't do that. It's that ambivalence of feeling that 90% of me still feels one way and 10%, the logical side of me, has to feel the other way and knows that and absolutely knows and doesn't dispute all the things that were said, you know, and the number of things that even in my mind I know are not true because I was told this and then he said something else and I know that's not true. But actually, it's really hard to balance that against the 90% and all the years that have been built up around the person that I knew. It's sad, but I do feel missing calls and I look around and think, could be here. Sorry, it does make me sad. Didn't think that. Sorry. Didn't think that would upset me, but it does. Yeah, he was such a good friend. Silly, isn't it? How can you be friends with a murderer?
His demeanour in court, he was calm, collected. He didn't seem agitated in any particular way. He didn't seem emotional. He didn't look scared.
Yeah, it was almost as if the guy was enjoying it. Obviously, there was a control thing with him. I mean, others have described him as a psychopath. People would know better than me, but yeah, there was something about him. That smirk and just a controlling element about him that was really weird.
In the courtroom, he was just staring ahead of himself, looking at his phone, not really taking part, just there in body and not in spirit almost. He didn't really show any recollection of remembering me or any emotion that I was expecting, really.
It was a long, long trial. But that was the interesting thing, was watching that, was realising that you hear someone that you've known since you were 10, but you didn't know him. You didn't know him at all. There was a side to him that you wouldn't want to know.
Webster returned to the scene of his crime when the jury visited in the course of the trial. Police had initially treated it as a tragic accident.
The prosecution wanted to set the scene for the jurors, so all travelled from Glasgow, High Court in Glasgow, up to Aberdeenshire and actually visited the crash site. Obviously things had changed down the years, but it gave them a picture of how rural the location was. So, I mean, he'd obviously planned the murder. The word was that he'd wrecked his crash site several times before.
In 1994, as I was coming up the slope from checking the dry cows, I seen the gentleman in the field looking towards a wee set of woods the other side of the road. But I approached him and asked him, first of all, you know, can I help you? And what are you doing? And he replied was that he was just out walking. That was it. Then, as I walked up to the dairy through the grass field, I could see a car parked further down the road, and he was making his way towards that vehicle. Then, a couple of days later, I noticed there was a vehicle in the woods. It was burnt out. That I noticed there was a big posy of flowers laying next to the burnt-out vehicle, which was still in situ. In my opinion, it was 100% Malcolm Webster I seen in that field on that day.
A jury at the High Court in Glasgow has found Malcolm Webster guilty of murdering his first wife and attempting to murder his second.
Despite his mild-mannered appearance, you are dealing with a very dangerous and a very wicked man who, if he were still at large in society, would be a danger to many women.
On sentencing, the judge, Lord Bannatyne, said that Clare's murder was cold-blooded, brutal and callous. The motive utterly based on financial gain, he said. And the attempted murder of Felicity Drumm, utterly cold-blooded as well.
It's also been a very distressing case, the judge noted, for Webster's former fiancée, who he planned to bigamously marry.
I'm very pleased that this matter is now at an end. I'm very pleased that the outcome of today was as it was.
Once he was convicted and sentenced to life in prison, that is the point at which Operation Livy finally could be put to rest. Malcolm Webster's in custody, he's held in prison, he can't harm MD anymore whilst he's in custody.
If I had my way, I would make sure he was in solitary confinement for the rest of his days, because he will learn, and if he's ever released, he will be an increasing danger in my book to anybody else he meets.
Very difficult time for a lot of people, because a lot of people had put a lot of faith in Malcolm over the years. There were people, my parents, for example, he'd been in our house and eaten with us and drunk with us and whatever. They couldn't believe that he would be doing something like this. They felt betrayed, no doubt about it. But people who knew him really well felt really, really betrayed.
In the context of what unfolded, what's really sad, I mean, I still find it very, very sad to think that Clare's gone. There was no inkling of any problem at all. It was nothing. They were happy. Was he thinking about doing something terrible at the time? I don't know. I find it very hard to imagine. But maybe that's just my lack of imagination.
For the trusting friend who finds out that Malcolm Webster is a convicted murderer, it destroys the sense of trust that they might have had in their former friend, and it also makes them question the basis on which they form friendships. The difficult thing for them to come to terms with is that simply that a psychopath is very good at manipulating and conning.
Malcolm wearing my hat, that kind of shows who Malcolm was, really. That was when we went to visit him, when he was working in Bexhill. And yes, Malcolm in a pink beret. It was just fun. It was just fun. I remember him singing as well. I had a pink beret, and of course he had to take it and sing about it.
The thing is, you know, he's following a classic pattern. He would have been learning for all his life how to get his own way. I don't think there's a good, quick answer to how you recover. Most people who've been in relationships with psychopaths and narcissists who have been controlled are also traumatized.
It was quite shocking. I know a lot of water had gone under the bridge by then. It was a lot of years had gone by. I probably felt a bit violated that, you know, we'd been an item. You know, we'd been boyfriend and girlfriend, and maybe if it had been a slightly different time, I might have been that victim. It's horrible.
Malcolm Webster's lawyers had argued that the original case against him was flawed. It was in 1994 that Clare Morris, Webster's wife...
I love when people say to me, it's pretty irrational that, given the evidence, Webster is still claiming to be innocent. But of course, it's another form of him being vulnerable or presenting himself within a narrative of being vulnerable. Claiming to be the victim of a miscarriage of justice, he's innocent of what he's been convicted of, is just the latest form of shaving his head and shaving his eyebrows and pretending that he's got leukemia. It's another way of drawing us in and making us want to sympathise with him. And of course, these are ingrained patterns of behaviour, so it's no surprise that Webster is still behaving like this whilst he's in jail.
No, he's a nasty piece of work, but again, so plausible. Whether it was a parochial little club and their, you know, pissy little funds, or a wife or girlfriend, the MO was the same. It was this find a position of weakness and then exploit that to his own advantage. And I think, you know, just he was such a master manipulator.
Malcolm Webster case really sticks out because it's so unusual. He doesn't have the profile and background of most of the criminals that I dealt with. He came from a very similar background to me. In fact, his father was a police officer, my father was a police officer. So our family backgrounds would have been very, very similar. So for him to grow up and then behave in this particular fashion is astonishing. He'd have an opportunity in life. Many of the people I dealt with really didn't have much of a chance. Malcolm Webster did, and for him to totally calculate the events that led to the death of Claire Morris and the attempt that was made in the life of Felicity Drumm and potentially was building up towards an event involving Simone Banerjee is cruelty on a level that's hard to imagine. Just cruel beyond belief. This isn't spontaneous violence that sometimes is all but too common in some of the major cities in the UK. This was somebody scheming and plotting for financial gain. Truly cruel.
This was the last case of any significance in my career. You know, just the most extraordinary, the most time-consuming, the most worrying, the most absorbing case that you could possibly imagine. A gas canister was attached to the life jacket. That, when you hit the water, that automatically inflates a life jacket. And there'd been a hole drilled in that gas canister. And Malcolm was the only person that had access to that boat.
The biggest thing that's hit me is that the sailing is most likely to have been where something was going to happen to me. It'd be very easy to drop somebody over the side of a boat. I do believe I'm very lucky. I think, you know, if it wasn't for Strathclyde Police, things may have turned out very, very differently.